Well, thank you, everybody, for being here this evening. Of course, nobody can do this alone, so I wanted to thank the team who actually has helped me and worked day and night to try to get this project off. Jeanette Law and Nicole Harrison, who handled all of the communications. Jeff Lynn from Bust Out Solutions, who was literally online day and night trying to build and then rebuild and then rebuild again the websites. And I would also like to thank Pam Miller for the work that she did with all the graphic design. Now, having said that, let me give you a brief description about what this project is. Design professionals were brought in to look at 5.5 miles of the Mississippi River, starting at the Stone Arch Bridge and moving all the way up to the city limits. Their charge was to create a vision for these 5.5 miles. And the goals of this vision were to establish parks again as the engine for economic development, to transform the river from a barrier to a connector, make those critical connections from the neighborhood to the river and across it, and then last but not least, try to reorient the city back to one of the three great rivers of the world, of course, the Mississippi River. There were a number of themes that they explored: sustainability, infrastructure, connections, and public space. We were very, very demanding. Each team was given only $30,000, but they had to make, they worked extremely hard to deliver 5 products to us, which you'll see tonight. They had to develop a framework for the, or a roadmap for the full 5.5 miles. They had to identify really critical connections from the neighborhoods to the river and across the river. They had to identify strategic sites, and these are not vacant lands, but instead sites where there are multiple convergences, either latent or obvious ones, that could be built on. And then they had to come up with a design concept for the highest priority site. And then last but not least, because we're into financial sustainability as well, they had to put estimates together for their proposals. One of the things that sets this competition apart from other competitions is the level of community engagement. And we worked very, very hard to set the stage for involving the community. We have the various collaborators who David and Cecily identified. We developed something called the Design Advisory Group, which is up to 60 community stakeholders who have provided us with a variety of forms of technical assistance. We had the designers put together a whole series of questions, which they then put to the community, because of we wanted to use the community for what they're best at, which is understanding their own community and the relationship to the river. And around that, they filled out a survey which was online, and we held a meeting, a public meeting, where close to 80 people showed up to give us their thoughts about the river. Youth engagement. Our goal was to create stewards for the future, and we had a number of youth come together and study the river, and you will see that their product in just a few moments. We also created something that's quite unique, which is a resource list. We worked with all the various institutions that work along and around the river and gathered all the information that is out there about the river and put it in one location. And this, of course, became the palette from which the designers worked from. And this resource list is available to the public now and into the future. Last but not least, spearheaded by Jeanette Law, was a tremendous communications plan that worked locally, nationally, and internationally through all sorts of different modes of communication. We have a wonderful jury who has took on the arduous task of reducing the number of designers from 55 down to 4, and then tomorrow they're going to get together and choose a winning team. And these jurors include David Fisher, who's superintendent emeritus, Tom Fisher, who's the dean of the College of Design at the University of Minnesota, Andrew Blauvelt, who you initially met, who is from the Walker, Bill Wenk, who is the landscape architect who got the commission to work on 14 miles of the Mississippi River for the city of St. Paul, Bill Morish, who unfortunately can't be here tonight because they got 15 inches of snow in New York. He is the dean of Parsons New School's Department of Constructed Environments. From the Minneapolis Park and Recreation Board, we've got Commissioners Irwin and Walensky. From the City of Minneapolis, we've got Mayor Archie Rybeck and Council Members Barbara Johnson and Diane Hofstede. From Hennepin County, we've got Commissioners McLaughlin and Stengline. And from the state, we've got Representatives Loeffler and Mullery. And so I'd like to thank them now for all the work that they've done. What you're going to see this evening is the culmination of 2.5 months of research, analysis, and synthesis in what is ultimately the most amazing proposals that will they show tremendous innovation, inspiration, and education in terms of helping us understand what could be for these 5.5 miles. And I do have to take a moment to tell you, we are only paying each team $30,000, but on average, each team has invested more than $250,000 worth of time, energy, materials, and expertise toward this. So we're looking at over $1 million worth of work for this project. So we really have to thank them. Before we look at the four presentations, we're going to show you a brief slideshow of what the students have done along the Mississippi River. We had two sets of students who work at the Minneapolis Park and Recreation Board. One is called the Youth Line Team and one is called the Green Team. The Youth Line Team worked on the east side of the river, looking at the area around Botno Park and how that connects to the river, and the Green Team was looking at the west side of the river, looking at how Farview Park connects to the river. And these teams went through a series of exercises through the sightseeing curriculum, basically looking at or learning how to think critically about the built environment and ultimately make proposals. And these exercises that you'll see really are an exploration about what is there, what was there historically, what's missing, and what could be. And once again, as I wanted to say before, the whole goal is really to create stewards for the future. These are the people who are going to be taking care of our parks and advocating for them in the future. So without too much delay, if I can get this going, here we go.
Take me to the river.
Wash me down.
Won't you cleanse my soul?
I can't thank all of you enough. There's 30 students, of which this is a wonderful representation of, and now you're all experts on the river, so wonderful. Thank you. Now, without too much ado, without further ado, I am going to kick off the design proposals. In a moment. The first proposal you're going to see this evening is by Ken Smith, landscape architect out of New York City. But I should say these projects are not led by just, or they're not just one single team, but instead they are upwards of 5 to 10 different types of firms who have all come together and approached this in a very, very interdisciplinary way. So you've got everything from landscape architects, urban designers, architects, ecologists, and public finance people coming together to help analyze all 5.5 miles. So having said that, the first team is Ken Smith, landscape architect, with Shop Architects, Green Shield Ecology, Borough Happold, ETM Associates, and Cone Partners Landscape Architecture. Thanks.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, and I would have to say this is a legacy project. It's an honor to be invited to participate in a project like this because it's the kind of project that one trains for their entire professional life to work on because of its capacity to fundamentally transform a city. I have a number of team members, if you'll stand up, who are with us tonight. And can I get full screen? Is that possible? So our project is called City of the River, and I think that it's well known that Minneapolis is known as the City of Lakes, but in fact, the more you dig into this project, you begin to realize that Minneapolis is actually the City of the River. It's the history of the city, and it's the future of the city. For our proposal, this is St. Anthony Falls, Nicollet Island, and the north part of the river is to your left, and we're going to move downstream during the presentation. We're going to begin with a short video. And this is the theme music tonight. I think it's really true in Minneapolis. There's a reason that the city is located on the falls. The falls are really powerful. They're beautiful, and they really have a strong emotional response for people. I mean, you're just drawn to them. They are what make a place. And that's why the Native Americans were there. That's why the settlers ended up there. People inherently want to be near the water. The water is the meaning of life. It's the source. It's the thing.
When I think about the river, I think of it as a living corridor, not just a passageway for barges. The river's been used for hundreds of years in so many different ways. The past meant taking the mussels, turning them into buttons, taking the forest, turning them into timber. All these things were valuable and useful. But what's the future going to be like of this river and the lands around it? How can we use this landscape and where the park will be in the future?
Rivers were the sort of interstate highway system of the last two centuries. So, of course, industry congregated around them. Now that industry is mostly gone because they have a different infrastructure to accrete around. And you have to fill that void. And how do you fill that void? Well, I don't believe, and I don't think Ken believes, that you do it by erasing that history. I think it's really, again, that idea about the water coming into the city and the city coming out to the water is also one that's over time. So it's, how do you make a park, how do you make something that's active, beautiful, elegant, relaxing, but still has that grittiness and that history and that sort of unexpected delight that makes cities such great places to be in.
Grand Rounds is a system, a connected open space system, and what's amazing about it is that each kind of node of the Grand Rounds has inspired the development of a very distinct neighborhood with its own character, its own destinations, and that's been very, very successful. So what's lacking is the long time desire to connect it, you know, once and for all, for there to be a complete system. As far as developing the river, I mean, the system, the park system, never addressed the river, you know, in the beginning, which is quite interesting, except for the River Parkway. And so it was only really a decade ago that downtown addressed it, and now going north, I think will transform, has the potential to transform Minneapolis's park system forever in a very progressive and innovative way.
We think that the park of the 21st century should be an agent for change, both for people and for nature. It's an opportunity for us to fix some of the things that are not working in some of the older parks. People right now are concerned about their health, they're concerned about the environment, and this is a good opportunity for us to provide those things that are lacking and provide people with opportunities to rebalance their daily life.
We're looking at a 21st century park, and you know, 18th, 19th, and 20th century parks were really all seen as kind of in the purview of the public sector, and that these were the responsibility of the public sector, and to a great extent, they still are. But I think as we start to look at these parks as 21st century sort of beings, if you will, that, you know, how are they going to be done? And what is the role of public-private partnerships? Or, these are something that's occurring all across the United States, and everybody's struggling with the same issues.
So that's the core of our collaborative team. These are the people who helped shape the vision that I want to present tonight. I think the number one priority is completing the Grand Rounds. And to do this, we're proposing a new green street called the Mississippi Greenway. This is the section. It's an integrated transit street with trees, a major greenway that is stormwater infiltrated with bioswales, a dedicated bikeway. And the Mississippi Greenway will connect to the West River Road down here, connect to the Victory Memorial Drive to the north, and also connect to 2nd Street and downtown. So it is this new corridor that will actually drive the redevelopment and access to the north side and serve as the spine for the new park system. We're also proposing new connections in the other directions, a series of clip-on bridges that can attach to the rail bridges and other bridges to provide bikeways and walkways. Esplanades along the river so you can actually get down to the water, get to the waterfront itself, and a system of continuous trails and bike trails. We're also looking at a series of neighborhood centers. These are not things that haven't been discussed before. The Broadway crossing, this connection is in the city's plans. We're proposing a new neighborhood, the Northtown Center on the north side near the area of the Gantry Park that we want to show. The Grain Belt District with the beautiful Grain Belt Brewery building, and infill housing in the East Side Terrace area. We're proposing developments that are based on sustainable infrastructure and an ecological foundation. And a big priority is restoring the natural heritage with new woodlands, new prairies, new riverine, riparian edges to reestablish the upper Mississippi as the flyway, the important ecological resources. And then there's a whole series of park systems, starting really with stormwater treatment, capturing the water that falls in the site, making sure that it's cleaned and properly handled before it moves into the river, and layering on top of that proposed open spaces, the bridges that will provide the connections, cultural and educational nodes, and the bikeways and recreational circuits. We also think a water taxi would be a great thing to have, and we're proposing to take the old barge landings, and we'd like to rehabilitate a number of the old barges and use those for recreational purposes. In terms of the actual design, there were a few things that really impressed us a lot, that really kind of drove our thinking. One was the mussels. Stephen made a really strong case for the mussels, because the mussels are an indicator species. You know a river is healthy if it has mussels, and we want to bring the mussels back. We want to have a healthy mussel population. So you're going to see this shape used throughout our design. We also think the logs, the old log jams, were really beautiful. It's a form that we're using. And fields, this sort of organized pattern, the kind of Jefferson democracy at the scale of the land and really the use of the land is really beautiful. And you're going to see that in our plans. And then we're proposing to actually reuse a lot of the old industrial structures because they're part of the history of the place. And there's a real efficiency to reusing them. We can get a lot more bang out of the public dollars by repurposing these structures. So we want to reuse the gantries, we want to reuse the silos, we want to reuse the domes, and we also want to reuse the tracks, the alignment of the tracks and the spur lines, because we think that's also very beautiful. In terms of structures, shop, our architects have developed a kit of parts, a kind of expandable structure that can come in big, little, and small, and solve a whole series of problems from bridges to concessions to shade structures and other sort of architectural amenities that we'll need in the park. And then we've done this by looking at 8 park scenarios. And I'd like to take you through these 8 scenarios tonight. I'll do it a little slower this time. You can see the scenarios along the river, and I want to take you on a trip down the river from the north to the south. The first scenario are the new islands. We're looking at the area at the very north end. This is the area just north of the power plant. This is where they used to store the coal piles. And we know that these soils are probably contaminated from the coal. And then there's also an area of industrial old use over here. And we're proposing to take the contaminated soils and cap them and create a series of islands. And then to create a little bit lower topography so we can create wetlands. And within that, to create a series of prairie potholes. So we're proposing a whole series of wetlands and marshes to help reestablish the flyway and to bring back the ecology on the upper part of the river. And this will be a new eco lab. This is the eco lab. It's one of those historic domes. We're proposing a new footbridge across the river, series of walkways and pathways. And that's the power plant over there. The next site down is the domes and the silos. That's this area here. There are 4 domes total and 4 silos. And we're proposing to use those for cultural uses. The silos will be an area for extreme sports. Two of the domes we think would be a great art annex. And one of the domes would be a theater or a camera obscura. And this is what that might look like with rock climbing and slides and very intense activity and using these large structures as an annex. It's a good idea. And we also think we can put arrays of photovoltaics on these gantries to make them productive. Farther down, we are proposing a series of fields, small-scale fields that deal with the heritage of this area in agriculture. And I want to talk first about this one. This is a grove of sugar maples. And we'd like to have rituals in the park, and one of the rituals will be the annual syrup festival, including pancakes. And we also think it'd be great to have a smokehouse for whitefish. Further down, there's community gardening, there's a community organic agriculture, there's orchards, there's meadows for bees, the bee populations as well. This is the fields. We imagine there'd be annual pumpkin harvest and pumpkin carving. It's a place of real community involvement and really stresses the issues of health and wellness, which are real issues in our society because of the diabetes problems we have. We need to make connections in the park with people to understand the relationship of land to their personal health and daily life. This is a sustainable parking lot, small scale and permeable. And we're threading these throughout the park because we know that Minneapolis is a place that relies on cars. This is a major picnic ground with a shade structure. It's scaled for large groups, corporate groups, or family reunions. And it's a structure that has a really beautiful built-in fireplace for barbecues and for warming up in the wintertime.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And farther down, this is the gantries. And this, I would say, is sort of the heart of the north side in terms of the park. This is the historic gantry structure. There's an old silo, and there's also a very beautiful structure that the trains pulled through here. We're proposing a very large water feature. It will be ice skating in the winter and wading pool and water spray in the summer. This would be the warming house and cafe. This is a large fountain, and this will be a major amphitheater. And these are those barge docks that we're saving. We would have a farmer's market and a floating eco lab and a floating swimming pool. And this is the waterfall. We only have two waterfalls in Minneapolis. We think there's a good case to be made for a third one, the North Falls. And when the explorers came, they looked at the St. Anthony Falls, which are only 16 feet tall, and they estimated them to be 50 or 60 feet tall. And this one will be 60 or 50 feet tall using the existing gantry structure. This is the ice skating rink. It would be for figure skating, and there would also be an area set aside for hockey. And then in the summer, it would become a wading pool and spray pool for children. And you can see there's the gantry, there's the waterfall. This is that silo with shops, observation deck on top. And this is that rail structure we'd use as a pavilion. And this is the amphitheater, which we think would be a great place. The gantry becomes a big proscenium for exhibitions and movies and plays. And the gantry also is a gateway. When you come to this part of the park, you will know that you're arriving to the river. Moving to the west, the north side, along 26th, Farview Park is right here. We're proposing to cap over I-94 and build a sports bar with soccer fields and other fields because the north side doesn't have those kind of facilities. And then it would also connect that neighborhood more directly to the new neighborhoods that we know will happen here and the parks along the river. Moving to the northeast side, I want to just take you through that. This is the rail bridge. This is one of the clip-ons, so we could have bikeway and pedestrian way that would go over. This connects to a rail spur and connects up to Botano Park. As you move up the east side, we're proposing to connect together Edgewater and Gluck and Marshall Terrace into a more continuous park, and we're proposing a continuous boardwalk on the river and connections down to the river. This is what we think that might look like. We're proposing to restore the river banks themselves. They're actually quite degraded. But we think it's very important to get people down to the water. Moving from the north, there's the islands. This is the terraces. There's a series of esplanades here. This is the terrace infill area. This is the grain belt area. The grain belt brewery is here. And to the south end of that redevelopment area, we're proposing at the Shearer Lumberyard site a big urban beach, which we think would be fabulous, where you can get sand between your toes. And we're proposing to make Boom Island into an island again. So this is Boom Island. We want to daylight the former channel. And this is the big urban beach, which has a really fantastic view of downtown. And this is what we think it would look like, a kind of opportunity that's not available anywhere else in the city. And one of those floating barges would be a new swimming pool right on the river. At Boom Island, this is the bridge from Nicolet. You can see we want to build a big ski hill with the soil that we dredge from the river. And this would be the new channel, and it would be specifically designed for mussel habitat. It would be the right depth and the right width to support the mussel population. And finally, scenario 8, the last scenario, is fishing the falls. We're proposing a great esplanade for fishing, with fishing cleaning stations and warming huts, a place where you can really, you know, cast into the water. In this area, we'd like to improve the trails and the connections so you can get down better. We think there's a great lawn opportunity here. And the last proposal is for a great overlook. One of the really frustrating things when you go to the St. Anthony Falls is you can't get close to them. You can't feel the water spray. And so we're proposing a cantilever overlook, the Spirit Overlook in honor of the Dakotas. And this is a place where you could get so close you could feel like you could touch that. So those are our proposals. We're going to end really where Minneapolis began, at the falls. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. The next proposal you're going to see is by Stoss Landscape Urbanism and Chris Reed. Once again, this is another group of teams, including Michael Maltzen Architecture, Util, Rafael Lozano Hemmer, Close Landscape Architecture, Applied Ecological Services, and HR&A Advisors.
Hello, good evening. I'm going to move some of these out of the way for a minute. I'm not that thirsty. What an extraordinary project this is. What a great turnout. I mean, we've been struck by the incredible enthusiasm and warmth shown by everybody we've been encountering over the last couple months. There's a real hunger for good work here, and we can really feel it. It's been propelling us forward in the last 2 months as we've been working crazily day and night. But we've had a blast, so I just want to thank everybody for the opportunity to come and share some ideas with you. In many ways, the North Riverfront Project hits at the heart of many of the challenges that contemporary cities face. Amazing but denuded natural resources, contaminated sites, aging infrastructures, complex jurisdictions, uncertain economies, constrained budgets, and frayed urban and neighborhood fabrics. And while these problems seem complicated and complex, and they are, they're not impossible challenges to overcome. But in part, it takes a great team, and one that revels in these challenges. We've assembled a team that are not just good collaborating designers and engineers and scientists, and they are, but we're also a collection of like-minded individuals whose interests coincide with one another and with the complex urban and environmental issues that we're encountering here in Minneapolis. It's a team that plays off one another well. We've been working cross-continent from Minneapolis to Boston to Los Angeles, online, on the phone, and of course, in person. We also spent a good amount of time on the ground to experience the true richness of Minneapolis's winter. And I swear, those are smiles beneath our grimaces. In fact, Michael's from LA, and we were talking, you know, if we win, maybe we can get a deal to get all of you out there for the next design meeting. More seriously, though, for us, it was important to begin with the river. It's many currents, it's many stories. The Mississippi is and has been the economic and environmental lifeblood for the city and for the continent, really. In this land of lakes, the river is unique and it's engaging. It's the prairie river turned working waterfront. It exhibits an incredible range of dynamic seasonal moods, raging in the spring, especially at the falls, serene and gentle in the summer, reflective in the fall, picking up on the colors along the banks, and very still and quiet in the winter, its frozen surface merging the river with the shoreline. Here is an incredible overlay of cultures and uses, of rich histories and evolving identities. In many ways, then, our proposal picks up on these experiences and these expressions. Streamlines is about the sheer, unfiltered experience of direct contact with the river and river life, in many ways and at multiple moments. And it's about weaving these experiences back into the everyday city. Streamlines is also a project about working ecologies, ecological systems and dynamics put to work to clean, to reconstitute this working riverfront, to guide a longer-term transformation of the city. But it's not about a single green line or even a double line along the river. Rather, this project is about multiple threads, multiple strands. It evokes the stories and lives of the people who live, work, and play by the river's edge and have done so for centuries. The proposed park strands create provocative new landscapes, but they also re-network existing neighborhoods to the parks and to the river. And they reach across the river as new green catalysts for community building. But while the project's ambitions are broad and challenging, the current situation is a bit disheartening. The river's out of reach up here, especially in the north. It's not part of residents' everyday experiences. These are neighborhoods that have been long severed from the river by infrastructure and industry. So what do you do? Before anything happens, before any parks can be built, we must lay claim to the river as civic space. The river itself becomes the park before the parks exist. Only then can we begin to seed the parks and elaborate new forms of city and river life. For us, the project starts as a spectacular environmental installation by interactive public artist Rafael Luzana Hemmer called Flow Intersect, which reinterprets river navigation practices as ephemeral guideposts in the night sky. And I'm going to let you listen to Rafael describe this proposal.
My proposal for Minneapolis as part of the team is a large-scale light sculpture called Flow Intersect, which allows people to easily see the meandering of the river across the city. It basically consists of a number of very powerful xenon robotic searchlights, which are placed at regular intervals along both shores of the Mississippi River as it crosses the city, in such a way that we'd see a vertebration of light across the city. And this vertebration would constantly be transformed by the river itself. In a way, it's a representation that is quite indexical of what's happening in the river, but that is visible across the entire city.
Of course, importantly, it'll be visible from the ground, from these neighborhoods that have been so long severed from the river. It'll be a guidepost so that you always know where the river is. Beyond the dancing lights in the sky, we also imagine bobbing luminescent rowboats, white contoured pods that glow evocatively at night, and floating barges refashioned as bandshells and amphitheaters, as swimming pools with diving platforms, all creating new kinds of experiences on and along the river before the parks exist. The barges can be mobilized early on and can work as ferries, can be launched from existing parks, for instance, or places where city streets extend to the river. Once this ground is prepared, then the framework can be built. It's made of a series of individual park strands, each with a distinct character and function. A river park, botanic overlooks, bridges and circuits, city islands, an energy forest, sporty circuits. The river park is the biggest. It's very much a working landscape, one that cleans the site and the city as it grows. It supports a full range of social and recreational activities and ecological life, nesting sites, skating canals, fields for flying kites, vibrant meadow habitats, shady groves for lazy days along the river. A water cleansing system structures the park. Stormwater from adjacent neighborhoods is cleaned in planted channels and stepped wetlands. This fresh and sweet water supports recolonization by native mussels, which in turn polish the water and reestablish vital food chains. Initial stages of park development are devoted to cleaning and holding land as parcels become available. Phytoremediation plots can polish existing soils and can eventually be underplanted with vital native forests. What you're looking at here is an animation of a staged occupation of the riverfront, one that begins by first cleaning the soil that's there with successive plantings of trees. Eventually, those trees can be overplanted by native species to begin to develop, reestablish the native forest. That strategy can then be expanded to adjacent sites as those parcels become available. Channel cutting follows, inaugurating a new green stormwater infrastructure for neighborhoods in the north, and effectively creating a series of park islands along the riverfront. At the channel outlets, new river islands are seeded adjacent to the navigation channel. These islands can be stabilized with native stones, which alter water flows, allowing the islands and new native habitats to grow. Incremental and flexible elaboration of these systems can seed larger scale transformations of the old port, creating a series of lush meadows and forest fields, working ecological landscapes, and spaces for new riverfront cultures. Within the park, the existing dome structures are renovated as part of an intensely active yet surreal landscape that beckons to the city's industrial past. This new industrial cultural center, with a few ideas probably familiar to you, introduces diverse recreation, culture, and activity programs, an interior world active both in the cold winter months and the hot summer days. In total, the River Park is an all-seasons retreat, but one with a nod to both the ecological and working legacies of the riverfront, where newly cleaned river mud can squish between a four-year-old's toes, where kids can come and touch the still backwaters of the Mississippi. Now, the botanical overlooks, these are something else entirely. It's a new kind of public garden, one that draws on the waste heat of the power plant and infuses the city with a new kind of ecological cyborg in which regional native ecosystems sit side by side with more fanciful and exotic environments. Here, waste heat from the Xcel Energy plant is distributed to the park overlooks, heating outdoor hot tubs, public swimming pools, greenhouses, and snowmelt plazas, which reduce salt and contaminant runoff to the river. Creating a participatory and sustainable spectacle. New green infrastructures link garden overlooks along the river. The garden's fingers extend back into the urban fabric as new water boulevards that collect and clean stormwater to be reused for irrigation. These new working ecologies, pools, greenhouses, and botanical gardens provide a luxurious and sustainable resource for both recreation and communal relaxation, a place for native cottonwoods, scarlet tanagers, and steamy hot tubs alike. But beyond the riverside parks, we propose a new connective infrastructure. Bridges have long played a key role in the life of the city and in the iconography of the river. But we want to extend this legacy incrementally while expanding the capacity of bridge infrastructure to take on new agendas, to become destinations and social spaces, not just connections. To this end, a first bridge arcs across and around the falls, providing an extraordinary direct experience of the water and power of the Mississippi. Program bridges continue north. At Fourth Ave and Nicollet Island, a welcome center bridge creates a new front porch from Minneapolis. A sports bridge is inserted upriver on the BNSF rail bridge. Curling and sauna bridges cross even further north and branch to connect the Riverwalk. This connective strategy can be extended to future replacement bridges as well, which will eventually be needed as existing vehicular bridges approach the end of their design lives. All of these connect to a proposed Riverwalk from the falls north. Now, importantly, this menu of bridge possibilities is something that could be built out over decades. Each one enriches the overall framework, but not all are required to fulfill its promise. But we can't just work along the river. We need to extend and expand its influence in order to allow the river to begin to permeate all aspects of river life. To this end, we imagine remaking the I-94 corridor as an energy forest filled with trees that create new vegetated habitats, reduce heat radiation, and clean air pollutants. Along the highway median, vibrating energy generators capture prevailing winds moving through. They can also be powered by the turbulence created by passing vehicles on the highway. Power generated here can then be transmitted to nearby public projects or sold back to the grid, thereby generating revenue for the project. On the east, we reimagine occupying leftover spaces along the existing rail spur as sports fields, ball courts, and playgrounds, connected by biking and walking and running circuits that can emerge incrementally and opportunistically over time, eventually creating an active, energetic zone of sweaty bodies and insidious play. But we can't stop there. The Mississippi and its new park strands will catalyze unprecedented kinds of urban neighborhoods along and within the network. A new live-work district where industrial uses are overlaid with residential flats above and which better enables riverfront redevelopment to the east along West River Road. A greenhouse district on the east, which establishes new community-oriented programs, schools, rec centers, greenhouses, fed by new sustainable infrastructures. And perhaps most spectacularly, the city island, River Orchards, a natural extension of the lifestyle and character of Nicolet Island, city living in a park, on an island, in the river. These are working gardens and orchards that serve as a public framework for low density but concentrated private development oriented to the river. Now, sustainability is laced throughout. For us, it's multi-layered and multifaceted. Sustainability is critical environmentally, sure, but also socially and economically. Upfront integration reduces operating and maintenance costs, reduces burdens on existing infrastructures, and can generate power and revenues for these and other projects. First steps are key. Our three-pronged approach distributes investments geographically and politically. They create new benchmarks for innovation and set the stage for early revenue streams. Here again is where our team can help propel this project forward. On projects like this, we know we can't simply rely on traditional funding sources for open space, so we work with clients as partners, identifying other partners, arts, education, technology sectors, for instance, and new resources, grant programs, and funding mechanisms. We integrate early-term staging strategies and events that get people excited and build momentum. And we can help frame out economic development models for both public and private investments in the short and long term. The project's identity strategy extends this work, creates a recognizable brand for the park system, and helps build momentum for fundraising and promotion. In all, the strategy is flexible and it can adapt. It's built off of existing land resources, ownership patterns, infrastructures, and designated high-priority sites. It leverages underutilized and waste resources, finds efficiencies in collaboration and cross-fertilization between urban and environmental systems, and builds new synergies between work, public life, and the landscape fabrics that support them. Importantly, it's a strategy that stakes new claims to the river, that seeds new growth, and that broadens the river's reach. It draws on the energy of the Mississippi in order to re-energize Minneapolis. It's a river, a park, a city, inextricably intertwined. Environmental dynamics, hardy work, and rich social lives together, weaving multiple threads for a new generation just as the Mississippi is woven for centuries. This is the new generation of parks. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. The next design team that you're going to hear from is a partnership between Tom Leader's studio and Kennedy Violich Architects. The other firms that they've actually been working with are Kestrel Design Group, Tim Griffin, Interfluve, Nippers Helberg, SRF Consulting, Donjek, Economic Development Services, and David Frank.
We're really happy to be here, and we're really happy that you're happy. Because that's so important. It's vital. It's crucial. I mean, these are the kind of projects that we like to do, where the community is so enlivened and so energized and so desperate for change that they welcome us into the community. We want to join your community. And that's the way we have to work. And that's why we've been working in the past, is to join you. And to develop a whole network of associations and relationships, and almost a becoming an honorary citizen to make that happen. So the three of us are myself. I'm Tom Leader. I'm a landscape architect. Donna Violich, and
Hello.
Sheila Kennedy. And we have been working together for some time. And we're different people, but you'll find. But we share some pretty important goals, which basically relate to. Investigation and inquiring into place, into the uniqueness of place, into the processes and the ways that you live. And the only way that we know how to do that is to come here and then sort of grow within you. So our team, we came and there were three of us, basically, and we got started meeting people. John Commerce was a huge help to us, and he introduced us to a lot of people. Lon Mickelson from Interfluve, and Peter McDonough, Kestrel Design. And we met Gianna King, a very important, you know, very, very helpful economist to us. Very large group of people just on the basic team, and most of them are here. They're lodged here in this place. And that's allowed us to gain a local understanding that we think is critical. And we've really focused on the things that are absolutely critical to what you need to do and to grow as a city. Now this team, this board has already filled up and overflowed into a network, River First Network, which extends to about 120 different groups, organizations, individuals, ranging from research institutions to groups involved with sustainable food, biking, conservation, energy, onward and onward. These are the connections that need to be made at a time like this in order to inform and to respond to your community. Now, the River First, what does that mean? Well, for us, there's a key concept here, which is confluence. Confluence is where things join together, where waters mingle. That's a key thing that was key to the Dakota. They had a concept called bidote, where the sacred joining of rivers. And we think it's because things are able to mingle in a way that is on an equal reciprocal basis, and their personalities can join. And we think the confluence is key to how we move forward in this project. We need to restore confluence. They've been lost over time. I mean, when a stream joins the Mississippi, that's a confluence. When water comes out of a pipe 20 feet up the bank, that's not. So we use that as a model for how to join the city back to the river. And as we do that, we are, and the whole River First Initiative is basically restoring the health of a vital ecosystem through these means. By first of all, by introducing clean, healthy stormwater back into the river in a way that's natural. But there's a confluence of a lot of other types of things, like information, green revenue, plants and animals, people and bikes. This is a very, very key joining of people to the river. And this is basically when we say river first, this is what we're talking about, that we need to find a way to work with the edges, to structure the basic nature of what, how it works now. We need to understand how it works. Now, the Bothe Falls plan is your reference here, and we just want to talk about that for a minute. It was a bold and ambitious plan, and it had some very good points to it. Number one, we think, was to create connections all up and down both sides of the river. And it also had an ambitious plan for all these white spots as well, just the ones on the west side. And the idea was to move in with housing and to support that with a very large infrastructure. And since then, the housing market has declined. Investing in infrastructure to do those things becomes difficult. And the question is, what do we do now to help support the city? How can the city grow in this spot under these conditions? And how can we establish these linkages that are moving across very difficult conditions? So it seems we need to ask some questions. Are there ways that cleaner industry, denser industry, can coexist with parks? Is there a way that the infrastructure that is here can actually serve in many ways as it is? Are there ways that the two neighborhoods, both the north neighborhood and the northeast neighborhood, can be strengthened within themselves before needing to plant additional housing? And then are there ways to join those neighborhoods back to the river itself? But we need to invent some tools to make this happen, especially along the edge of the river. Now, thanks to Lon Mickelson, we understand how this works. Basically, when a river is carving against one shore, it deposits on the other. So it's eroding, it's cutting. And then it's depositing on the side, creating the possibility for molding. So there's two actions that take place here in this project. One is the carving of the erosive side and the depositing on the other. This allows us to structure a landscape and create connections all through the park that wouldn't have been possible otherwise if we hadn't been thinking in cross-section, if we hadn't been thinking topographically. Topography is the key. Interaction between water and soil and topography is what makes landscape.
So I'm going to give you a very brief overview of a tour of our project, and then we're going to go very quickly and visit a number of sequences in the project. So this, of course, is the existing conditions, and we can see the kind of impact that I-94 has had, kind of cutting off the north neighborhood from the river. So we begin with that idea of what would happen, how could we think about this park if we actually consider the river first. So the river's operations, the way that it carves, the way that it deposits, are the first step that guide our framework. Farview Park is a new land bridge that connects the city's historic high point with the river. There is also an innovation district, River City Innovation District. We then expand about 14 acres of eco-infrastructure with wetlands and a green port. Just continuing with this overview, we have a series of great bluffs, which have stormwater ravines and terraces on the northeast side. We have a demonstration site on Shearer Park, which includes a restored Halls Island and downtown. So talking then about a river first, to make a 21st century park, we had to really consider and identify four challenges, which we think are kind of at the essence of what Minneapolis will need to think about, prepare for. And these are water, not only water quality, but what will be the ability of the city in 40 years' time, let's say, to predict high water or low water events, to monitor those events. We think that that's going to be very important. There's the health, of course, of the river, but there's also community health and the city's health. how can we get sustainable mobility and transportation, given that industry and transportation are the most energy-consuming sectors today in Minnesota, and how can we grow a green economy? So in our team, River First, we considered these needs not as opposing interests, but as a kind of confluence of a larger ecology. So we ask, how can a set of interdependencies about what the river needs, what the city needs and the community needs, how can this shape a next generation park system? One that would be agile enough and practical enough to be implemented in a short 3, 4, 5 year time frame, but one that would also help to position and prepare Minneapolis for the next 40 years and more, to 2050 and beyond. So those are the two time scales that we looked at. And we asked, amongst those ecologies, how can the way in which the perceived waste of one ecology be used to build or contribute to the others? And what could be the best set of ideas with the lowest carbon footprint impacts? Because we all know construction is very intensive in terms of its footprint. How could we leverage the existing assets that the city has and the infrastructure that already exists? So to begin with health, for example, we looked at the Farview land bridge connector, and you can also see located in the other colors restaurants, existing slow food establishments, the community groups that we've spoken with, urban agriculture initiatives, Homegrown Minneapolis, the mayor's new 2010 urban agricultural initiative, bringing those together along with recreational and physical health along the river, and thinking about health at a multitude of different scales.
So here you are standing at the top of the mountain on Farview Park, and basically that's the historic high point of the city. Not everybody knows that anymore, but it's a fantastic place. It was the first park that Grover Cleveland ever designed here. We would like to basically find a way to extend the expression of Farview Park all the way to the river. And this is an idea about having a vista, and having a prospect, and having invitation to opportunity that can unfold itself and draw the entire community from the north side down to the river, and create amenity for a new river city within it. Now, as this park unfolds, the park at the top moves through an existing neighborhood that can be retained and will gain a lot of value. A major land bridge across I-94, done as a standard freeway overcrossing. It has a series of rooms that basically unfold and step down slope, so it descends. This is about the descent of people and water that are moved along those two parallel loops. And the people cross over streets, and then the water crosses underneath. And as the water descends from the north neighborhood, it is vitally cleaned, concentrated, and then spread out into a delta near the river. Also very important here is that this is a farm. This is an important concentration of community-led, community-coordinated, and organized urban agriculture that will be a new center for food in the city. And not just food, but thinking about food, about selling food, and about focus on cuisines of the diverse neighborhoods that are in the city. It's also basically a place to focus value and amenity for a new river city that will collect around that space. And lastly, it connects down to the river to a way of moving along the river continuously. Now we have, a very simple section here, but basically the idea is that we need to keep a lot of these accesses for barges and other kinds of access, moving toward the river. So we use sculpted landforms. All these, dredge materials, all things have been deposited. They're soft and molded and fertile. Can be shaped into a continuous topography and then cross over with bridges all the necessary spots and keep business and industry functioning in relationship to the river.
So as Tom said, we want to reconnect the historic city high point with the river and establish a farmer's market there. We would propose the adaptive reuse of the Gooden building, which is in good shape, a historical building, and transform it to a community market. This would have access to the 26th Street bike trail, a new Prairie Loop clean shuttle bus that we're proposing, and pervious surface car parking. Now, it's sort of interesting because Minneapolis Farmers Market, the first outdoor fruit and vegetable market, opened in 1876, and there's always been a relationship between the river and farmers market, and so we want to celebrate that again.
So the park is a place for recreation, it's a place for community development, and it's a place where healthy, nutritious food can be farmed. So as we spend time in the park, as we enjoy cooking, growing, and making healthy local foods, and as we realize savings in municipal savings in the transport of produce, which is almost $500,000 a year in Minneapolis, we can take more steps towards ensuring the river's health. So we see this as a way of reaching out also in terms of education. There would be a series of river-first clean products, clean dishwashing and washing machine soaps, clean organic fertilizers and road salts, a bit prosaic maybe, but these are the kinds of things that we think, the kinds of vehicle that the park can be, the vehicle that the park can be, and the kinds of things, the kinds of impacts that will profoundly affect what happens upstream, and that's vitally important for the health of the river. So food is the first wealth, but as we know, jobs are also good, and Farview Park will be a kind of catalyst in our planning strategy for the future of this area, which is an innovation district where there will be work with medical, scientific, and prototyping technologies. We call that the River City Innovation District, and we'll be able to increase the job density from about 2 or 3 per acre to over 100 per acre with the River City District. This is a view looking back up at Farview Park, seeing some of the bridges, some of the bermed spaces, no removal of existing housing, and a kind of a vibrant market street that could occur there.
So the confluences, here they are. And what we're doing, essentially, is intercepting stormwater higher upslope as much as possible, and then we are creating a series of, it's a simple thing, daylighted streams that are able to reach the river and move water slowly through a series of planted wetlands, terraces, and so forth. It's different on each side. On the east side, essentially, we are carving. That's the nature there. So we're cutting in ravines that have terraces, which let the water almost switch back down to the river. And on the west side, we're working in a more riverine geometry, molding the land, working parallel in some places, then widening out much more in others.
So how can we work with the existing resources in the city? You know that, or you may be aware that all over cities in the United States, they're losing wetlands, and that's critically important for climate change when there may be more low water events, which dries soil as hotter temperatures evaporate. And as that hot air goes into the atmosphere, you have a greatly increased chance for really severe rainstorms, so that there's a possibility of high water events and floods. So Minneapolis, you're in luck. There is a very large 7-acre wetland that's already sitting on that site. And so what we propose to do through some historical research is simply uncover it. So we're going to go back in time. You're going to start to see that emerging in 1969. There was an island there called Plummer's Island. And there was, in fact, a kind of a wetland condition that was already there. So we're resetting the time dial in a way to 1934, recovering a wetland area that's existing and developing it as part of the park.
So this is that wetland. And it is basically the flagship on the west side of our strategy of molding and shaping land to receive water. This area has some separation from the river, from the Mississippi, with a series of barrier islands that are connected with small bridges and pathways. Bicycles are kept more to the interior, and then between there and the shoreline is a new aquatic garden, which is dedicated to the cleaning of the water, but also the diversity of all the kinds of species that can exist in a very diverse bottom condition, from between 6 inches and 18 inches and 3 feet. It's a place for canoeing. It's a place for renewing nature, and when I say renewing nature, it's not like it comes back and then it's just there and it's a stack. This is a place that's going to continually change with every flood, with every deposit of sediment, and so as we go forward, it will never be the same. And we need to accept that in all of these strategies we're talking about, that this is an evolving, continually responding to river dynamics. And this is a cross section that shows you specifically how the land is molded to carry treatment cells that are planted with emergent and riverine wetland. And these step from one to the next, like a series of trays. And sometimes they move like this along the edges when it's tight, And when we have big areas, they can work concentrically. So there's a lot of ways of handling that move. We might move through 10 or 11 of these treatment trains, and then it's covered by riparian forest for cover. And as you see up below several times, we're showing you the diversity of the species from the water to the wetland, to the onshore and upland, that will progress as you initiate the first step. So this is a landscape in transition to a climax state. And this is the experience. It's close to the water. It is within a place that has views both sides of an enclosed aquatic garden of the wide open river. And most importantly, these are landscapes we need to get used to, because climate is changing. We need to be able to absorb the capacity of global warming, which means bigger floods and bigger droughts. And we need to create infrastructures that can absorb and be more resilient within the framework of materials we're employing here.
Moving along on our tour, we're trying to think about the green economy. We looked at a number of different global ports, and our proposal here is to to evolve the port from a barge port, which it is, which would be the first condition, an existing condition, to a green port, and then finally a clean energy portal, which would be a corridor for Buffalo Ridge and also other areas in the state for the production of wind energy. Those transmissions corridors are being planned now. And so what we have is a kind of key infrastructural condition where you have two very important train lines, the presence of the river navigation and the interstate. And we think that offers quite a lot of competitive advantages in 2050 in terms of mobility and green economy for Minneapolis. And so we think that that needs to remain. So throughout this entire process, at community meetings and in presentations, people would ask this question: where should industry go? Where should the port then go? Where should it move to? And our response is a little bit different. In phase one, we imagine a continuous rivershore trail on the north side that rises above barge terminals that does not impede any existing operations. In phase two, we evolve the port, and we move to a regional portal for the green economy. So we don't think it's best for the river to move industry somewhere else and just hide it and keep it the same. This is a very unique chance, I think, for the city and for business leaders to evolve the way in which industry is conducted in Minneapolis and prepare Minneapolis to be competitive in the green economy of the 21st century. Now, the port today is actually part of the landmass of Perkins Hill. And if you look at that section, you can see how, using the section, we double the handling capacity of the port, and we do that in half the footprint. We consolidate the port to make it more efficient. We use onshore power, which would be provided by the planned solar installation that Xcel is considering, or through wind energy. That's cold ironing. That means that there's no diesel, no noise, less disruptance on the river. We use clean energy from wind. This would be the first place in Minneapolis which would have an electrical vehicle charging station and an electrical bus charging station. So we provide a municipal eco-infrastructure that improves river health and helps prepare against these large water events, a comprehensive 14-acre stormwater management system with wetlands and pervious surfaces. We have opportunities for parks and trails, and we have economic benefits, very significant ones. We would increase the job density in the green port from 14 persons on 22 acres, which is the density today, to over 100 persons per acre, with a mix of industry on grade, clean industry on grade, efficient container rail transfer points, and green economy enterprises and business incubators above. So, you can't move the industry somewhere else. We walk on water in Minneapolis because of the aquifers. We'll just be taking the problem and moving it somewhere else if we don't address it now as part of this project. So we have a comprehensive idea about mobility. There'll be a series of interconnected pedestrian trails, which I'll talk about in a moment. We have the Nice Ride stations, which are located throughout. We make connections to the terminal, the city terminal, and we propose a new clean shuttle loop that will travel around. It's called the Prairie Loop, that would bring people from downtown to River City and the port in 12 minutes. Not bridges. We said we didn't want to do just an ordinary bridge. We did not want to do bridges. We wanted to do not bridges. Not bridges are piggyback bridges. They're pedestrian paths. They're bike ski appendages that can be fastened on to existing bridges. They tie that critical knot between the lower shore elevations, the river shore elevations, and the higher higher level of the bridgeheads. We also propose a mobile phone application, which would be powered by solar Wi-Fi, also on these bridges. That's the extension of the RiverTalk app. Now, you might think that's amusing, but Locavore, which is a mobile phone application for sustainable food, nets $20,000 a month. So if you extend that across a year, an application like Minneapolis Parks RiverTalk could pay for the deplowing on all the knot bridges at the least. You can talk to the fish, you can check the acidity of the water and the pH of the water, and you can have a different kind of expanded, augmented contact with the river. We think that this can help attract both local and national educational partnerships with organizations such as the Nature Conservancy, Conservation International, who are looking, in fact, for a mobile phone platform for their resources. There's also the opportunity to make public an existing infrastructure, which I'm sure almost no one in this room knows about, but which will be very important, I think, in the future. And that's the Minnesota Water Services USGS real-time water monitoring system. It's online. You can check it on your mobile phones when we're done. And we propose to use bridge illumination on the knot bridges to signal how the river is feeling, to signal the river health with illumination and light. So this is a view that you would see looking down on Plymouth Bridge, looking at the knot bridge that's winding around there. In this case, I think that the Loppet ski race is being conducted around the bridge. Lastly, and very quickly, biohavens. So this stuff, there's 500,000 pounds of PET that's generated in cities like Minneapolis every day that come from water bottles and other things. How can we take that stream of waste and create a very lightweight, very sustainable way of remediating natural habitat? And so this is the proposal of the Biohaven Islands. They're floating islands. They're made out of 100% recycled PET. They're tethered to bridges. They produce 7 acres of habitat that would really allow migratory birds to come back in a really significant way. If you think about it, as Peter McDonough, our conservation biologist, has said, When the migratory birds come to Minneapolis, they encounter today really unfortunate circumstances. So we think that this could be a very low energy, low carbon way to create a really significant island habitat.
Here we're looking at the east side bank, and this is where we're beginning to employ the idea of carving and shaping. So just basically, the riverbank itself needs help in terms of wave action, erosion. So this is being stabilized with stones and live willow cuttings, ripe riparian shrub and forest climbs to the top, and over the plain, over the very is an elm forest, very high canopy, with a molded shaped landscape that can detain some water. But the big idea here is moving along the edge, finding a way to make that the most exciting moment in your life. Now, there's different ways to move along the shoreline. They should be different, and they should be diversified. Now, we showed you before a rendering of somebody walking down close to the water, and something's only like 6 feet wide. That's important. No bikes. Bigger bikeways behind. We showed you there's a fishing trail, which is just a very, very narrow way of getting down to the water. We think a promenade. You know, the ATF had a promenade, and it was marketed as a big, long, straight or curving thing. I can't remember. Huge. And you were close to the water. We think it's better to be high above the water and to be very diversified in the kind of experiences you have. So we are creating edges with seat walls and shaping of the grade to make a trail, to make a promenade, which runs out on bluffs and then curls back around ravine terraces and then back out again to another bluff. And each time going through a different space, a different series of perspectives, so that you can move within nature in exhaustible in different ways. This is the same spot in summer with the all the diversity of the species climbing the slope, the very high canopy of the elms over the entire plateau above.
I'd like to tell you about our demonstration site, Shear Park. This image is one of Minneapolis's first industrialized processes. It's the cutting and logging of trees. And it is both terrifying and inspiring at the same time. This raw material records the movement of logs that echo the flow of the river, the flow of an economy that became all too short-lived. A proposed Shearer Park, bounded by Graco Lighting, the Arts District, the Grain Belt, the Marina, Boom Island, and Plymouth Bridge, is a demonstration site that represents all of the core values of the River First Initiative of water, health, mobility, and a green economy. The site is located along the only river bend with a southwest exposure, offering a beautiful view of the city and maximum exposure to the sun. It recovers Hall's Island, lost in the 1930s when the water channel was filled for lumber activity. It is served by bicycle and pedestrian knot bridges that wind their way across Plymouth Bridge. It has a nice ride station, and it finds itself along the proposed Prairie Loop shuttle. We envision housing, and we have provided enough, 200 units, to multiply current tax revenue by six times to generate a tax revenue stream to defray the cost of future parks and maintain and operate Shearer Park. On this 12-acre parcel, there are 240,000 square feet of market-rate housing, artist work live space, an aquatic center, commercial space, and a community arts center with an entrance off Sibley Street to provide an opportunity for working adults, youth, and retirees access to studio and learning space. We celebrate the way natural systems are measured and change over time, over season, the character it exhibits from sandy beach to grassy wetland. We have conceived of this park as a great urban beach where your experience is an immersive one, where you wade, you swim, you see frogs and turtles swim. The former log jams of the past are transformed into large urban furniture, partially submerged, for the public to bathe, relax, and read. We have a vision that someday soon you can get up at 5 in the morning and go for a kayak ride before even going to work, or ice skate in the winter, or even swim on a warm summer's evening. In the not too distant future, blue and green lifestyles will become more and more important in urban centers. Youth will have a choice where they want to live. So a confluence of these lifestyles will be a critical recruiting tool for cities trying to attract the best minds to live in this new creative city and enjoy the arts and this unique asset. Beyond a demonstration site, we see Shearer Park as a launching point that expands the current marina and complements the North Mississippi Park put-in near the Camden Bridge, 4 miles north.
Last zone you want to talk about is downtown and the falls. What we're trying to do, it's been talked about quite a bit, to create a gateway into downtown using Nicollet Avenue and to create a new urban living room for the city at the heart of that. So we think this should function as just one more tributary, one more confluence that is based on water. So this park is collecting water within its bounds using existing parking lots, taking over basically a 4-block area, and it channels it into a series of streams that move along Nicollet Mall, transfer over to the other side, and they continue on their way, daylighted, sustaining a riparian forest all the way to the Mississippi River in the background. So this is a forest gateway. This is a place about water. The forests also frame important urban greens that work basically the way Bryant Park would work, and also incorporates all the features of the existing cancer survivor garden, so it's well fit in. Last thing I want to talk about is Spirit Island. This is another way of rejoining the heart, which is different, more spiritual. And this island was lost, and it was placed important in Dakota lore. Our idea now is to mark this. We need to recognize the footprint of what's been lost during this period of time. So what we're doing is creating or suggesting an image of basically a hole in the water. which is done by using some simple technique of old millroom type of walls and gently lit from within. But this is just an idea. You know, we can't really bring that back. We need help from Dakota people. We need much more interaction and discussion with you. But we want to talk about loss and how to renew. And that's one of our early symbols of that.
So in closing, we did want to try to blend our three voices with you tonight personally. We thank you for your patience with that. We do have a video, but we decided not to show it to you since it'll be seen by all online very soon. So instead, we just want to say that this is a very personal project to us, that we think that the city, the Parks Board, and the citizens have in front of them a really remarkable opportunity with this initiative. We've had a chance to really rethink the way that we engage the Mississippi River in our daily lives and at many different scales of impact. We think that's what's at stake, the chance to rethink in our daily lives how we engage with the river. And in doing so, we have a chance to create a park of confluence, a new type of park that draws on older ways of thinking, a park that serves many functions, providing eco-services for the city, connecting communities with land and with healthy food, attracting the brightest minds to Minneapolis, growing a green economy, and providing a fantastic place for physical recreation and for reflection, rejuvenation of the spirit. It's a time to listen, and we've begun that process with the River First Network or Consortium, and now it's time to take steps to establish the ongoing legacy of a living river. This is what we think can happen when we consider River First. We hope you join us going forward. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that last presentation. Last but certainly not least is Turnscape out of Beijing. The teams for Turnscape include Alta Planning and Design, SVR Design Company, Meyer Shear and Rockcastle, Applied Ecological Services, and Community Design Group.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for having us. My name is Steve Durant, and I'm from Alta Planning and Design. Some of you may know me from being the leader of the Above the Falls plan, and others from writing the 100-year plan for Cedar Lake Park and Cedar Lake Regional Trail, soon to come to fruition this coming year. I'm project manager for the Terrenscape team.
Hi, everyone. I'm Nate Cormier with SVR Design in Seattle. We're helping Turnscape maximize landscape performance.
I'm Tom Meyer with Meyer Shear and Rockcastle Architects. Our office is in Mill City Museum. We are architects, and our office will be a home base for the Turnscape team and has been. And we have done about 20-some projects in the Central River District in the last 30 years.
I'm Kong Jian Yu. I'm design charge of this project. I should congratulate my colleagues to have such wonderful presentation, and I'm honored that we share so much values and so much ideas about the design. I'm also honored because I work with the cities that had a vision, and they can make it happen. Remember 1880, when Hollis Cliffland was called upon to develop this wonderful park system we call today the Grand Rand. And it was until 1930s that this park system was largely being developed. And this vision lasts till today. So now this park system becomes the best in the world. And I am also honored because I know I'm working with an incredible community. I remember just 2 months ago, myself and my team joined the community meeting, and you know, organized by this planning commission of Minneapolis, and people talking about you know the increase and decrease of land value, the increase and decrease of payment, and increase decrease of employment opportunities. And suddenly, from the audience, stand up one normal neighbor, a middle-aged woman. And she raised a voice. She asked a question, what about the birds? What about the birds that travel along these Mississippi corridors? I was astonished. I was surprised. I know this community is incredible. They worried, they care not about just about their backyard. They have bigger vision. They have big value. They have big mind. So I think right now we have this momentum. The community are ready to have a big vision, a bigger, a larger. So I'm honored to get involved in developing this and renew the vision which you have had 130 years ago, and you have a big vision and an opportunity to carry on this vision for the next century, and pick up the leadership again to lead this world to build a new green city, a new harmonious community. Now I wanted to quote Cliffland's words, which he wrote just 1880, when he developed the Minneapolis Parkway system. He said, quote, they will have wealth enough to purchase all that money can buy, but all their wealth cannot purchase a lost opportunity. And I think so opportunity is coming. And I want to share what we think the opportunity is. Please turn off the light.
We are living in a problematic 21st century. We face global warming and a degraded environment, an uncertain economy and social inequality, cultural conflict and a loss of local identity. And yet, we can make this a 21st century of change and reinvention. Old values have to be reevaluated. New ethics and new aesthetics have to be invented. And most importantly, new solutions have to be and can be implemented so we can build on the foundations of previous generations a more healthy and beautiful Minneapolis. Our vision is of the Upper Riverfront as prototype for a new relationship, a smarter relationship between the people of Minneapolis and their river, which can inform our way of living within nature across the city and region. Our design approach celebrates the resilient river. We believe in the power of nature to heal and the relevance of the river to the life of the people of Minneapolis. We take the long view and see that changes in industry along the banks have happened before, driven by the market, but also by the guiding hand of public policy and the aspirations of the river's citizens. Our purpose, then, is to aid in healing the riverfront as a place of critical ecological importance, as well as a place for working and living. Where the river has been an excuse for dividing neighborhoods and peoples, we desire a place for solidarity and play. We concur with the view that parks can create new value on adjacent lands, but also propose that a new ecology of parks is necessary that makes productive use of the rich riverfront lands and waters, as well as the people on its shores.
Welcome to the Resilient River, a 50-year framework for strategic investment along the Upper Riverfront. This framework was developed in response to four key challenges. The first is to evaluate the park system for all of its potential performance and rebuild a healthy ecosystem. The second challenge is to meet the needs of the riverfront neighborhoods that have been dramatically underserved in terms of access to parkland. The third challenge is to foster new industries and new economies. The fourth challenge is to help Minneapolis become the city of the river again. In response to these challenges, we have developed three strategies. The first is to build an ecological infrastructure. We will strategically identify landscape assets and design a network that protects and enhances critical natural and cultural processes. This network will secure vital ecosystem services for future generations, with habitat for migrating birds and wildlife, greenways and open space for people, as well as stormwater management and other green infrastructure to see Minneapolis through the environmental challenges that lie ahead. We might envision this network like a tree, with the river as its trunk, fingers of green linking the river to the urban fabric as its branches, and the neighborhoods as twigs and leaves. Our second strategy is to reorient urbanism to the ecological infrastructure. As the network grows, we can begin to restructure the city around the river. We recognize six key corridors that will follow the ecological infrastructure network. New opportunities for horticulture, education, art, industry, commerce, and residential living will complement and link to existing assets in adjacent neighborhoods. The Resilient River is a long-term vision. It is rooted in the understanding and strengthening of systems at the broadest landscape scale. The Resilient River will clean the water. It will create diverse habitat for wildlife. It will connect us with greenways and transit. And it will inspire activation of the riverfront in all seasons. But we understand that this vision must grow organically over time from the landscape we know today. So the third strategy is to curate the vision through time. Riverfront investments must be strategically conceived to work within today's realities while catalyzing a future worthy of the Mississippi River.
Community engagement and planning for the Resilient River will take time. While this is underway, let's immediately attract attention to the riverfront and prepare the ground for future improvements. Existing industrial buildings and artifacts will become canvases for iconic murals. Underutilized ground will be planted with rustic crops like sunflower, alfalfa, and clover to improve soil fertility and bring immediate productivity. Our first phase will concentrate on improving access to the river. The first project will be an urban waterfront park that recreates the historic Halls Island and brings visitors into immediate contact with the Mississippi River. This project will be initiated on the Shearer Brothers site, inspiring redevelopment of the adjacent blocks. Diverse water experiences for visitors will mix with unique ecological habitats. We will excavate a side channel for swimming and water games. Drawing on its logging heritage, the new Halls Island will host wooden diving structures and floating boom platforms. An urban beach and ribbon benches will provide surfaces for sunning and picnics. Excavated material will be reused on site to form savanna peninsulas supporting a skyway linking the Broadway and Plymouth bridges. Lessons learned from this first project will be applied to future earthworks to reestablish Boom, Hennepin, and Spirit Islands, reforming with Nicollet Island an island district. A second project will link Perkins Hill and the City View School to the riverfront. Here, a covered pedestrian walkway will bring neighbors and students to enjoy and learn from the river. Its iconic form will anchor an education corridor and signal that North Minneapolis is reclaiming its riverfront identity. Linear parks will weave up and down each side of the river. Rail cars and winding terraces will be filled with community gardens. Fingers of green will reach deep into the neighborhoods. Our second phase involves transforming the river environment into a series of stages for the experience of natural and cultural performances. The Upper Harbor Terminal will be transformed into a horticultural enterprise zone. A soil factory will remediate polluted soils barged in from other riverfront sites. It will also act as a composting facility for green waste. Winter garden greenhouses will be warmed with heat recovered from the composting process and from the nearby power plant. Community gardens, tree nurseries, and biofuel plantations will occupy remediated sites. A new North High School and community college in the education corridor will grow around the pedestrian walkway from Perkins Hill. Their curricula will focus on serving the emerging industries of the upper riverfront, horticulture, environmental restoration, and biotechnology. A large wetland park will offer a laboratory in ecological restoration techniques. The wetlands will cleanse water drawn from the Mississippi, as well as surface runoff from the neighborhoods. Islands for wet meadow and riparian habitat will be built from recycled demolition materials and organics from the soil factory. Migrating birds and other wildlife will have a safe place along the river. Clean water from the wetlands will flow south to an aggregate art park. Sinuous canals here will allow water play among aggregate piles, prairie ribbons, and industrial artifacts. The canals will become circuits for skating and skiing when winter comes. An amphitheater will host performing arts. Situated with a great view of downtown, the theater will attract visitors from both sides of the river and the entire city and anchor a new arts corridor. These improvements will solidify the upper riverfront's place as a healthy and accessible destination for all. Our third phase will include the transportation infrastructure for new industries and new communities to emerge along the upper riverfront. A streetcar loop will extend the city's transit network to catalyze new development. The BM Bridge will be transformed to bring the streetcar and pedestrians to both sides of the river. The city's legacy of parkways will be extended up both sides of the river to complete the Grand Rounds vision. Walkers, joggers, bikers, and drivers will all enjoy a continuous river landscape. With new infrastructure in place, the upper riverfront is ready for a new lifestyle to grow along the river's banks. Therefore, our fourth phase is the full development of new industries and new residential communities. Some existing industries will be relocated to a new industrial corridor with better rail and highway access. Corporate campuses will emerge along these new green corridors. High-paying clean tech jobs will add economic resilience to the region. Of the residential communities, the flagship is a carbon-neutral neighborhood along the streetcar line of the Western Terraces. We envision a truly 21st century lifestyle magnet that demonstrates cutting-edge technologies adapted to local climate. This neighborhood will be built with the most innovative on-site infrastructures for water, waste, and energy. Residents can work in the surrounding biotech, art, and education corridors, or commute by bicycle or streetcar to downtown Minneapolis. Now let's take a look at what it's like to live the new lifestyle of the resilient river. Hey.
have real experience from the past of using the power of the river in a sustainable way, breaking the hard wheat of the north with only the falling of water, and even now turning that motion into electricity. Our design is presented in that spirit, and a belief in the river itself to steady our minds, fill our hearts, and steel our resolve for the challenges before us.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Yu, and thanks to all the teams who have put together these amazing and inspiring proposals. As far as next steps are concerned, tomorrow is the jury, where the 14 members are going to be getting together, and I would say they've got their work cut out for them. Their charge is to select a winning team. And of course, they've had an opportunity starting on Monday to evaluate not only the videos like the one that you've just seen, as well as attending this evening, but there's also online a 24-page summary report created by each team that I encourage you to look at. I can only imagine how much discussion there's going to be tomorrow. It's going to be quite lively, I think, if the last jury was any indication. Starting tomorrow, the videos are going to go live online. And I really encourage you, as I said, not only to look at those, but also to look at the 24-page documents. And there's an opportunity for you to comment online about these design proposals. So you can go to the Minneapolis Riverfront Design Competition.com and find all that information. The winner is going to be announced on the 10th of February. We're actually having an event at 11 o'clock at the Nicollet Island Pavilion to announce the winner. Having said that, it's open to the public. But anyway, having said that, it is really my pleasure to now introduce the new superintendent for the Minneapolis Park and Recreation Board, Jane Miller.
As this new superintendent of the Minneapolis Park and Recreation Board, I am so excited to be here in Minneapolis. I couldn't feel more fortunate to come to Minneapolis at this exciting time for our city's parks. As we've seen with the riverfront in the past, parks investment and strategic sites provide the framework for which the communities can build together. Tonight, we've been presented with four visions for the recreation of half of our city's 22 miles of riverfront, 11 miles along both sides of the river, touching on some of the oldest neighborhoods and industries. Now you're here because you have a passion for our city, for our river, and for great design. And we, the Minneapolis Park and Recreation Board, the Minneapolis Parks Foundation, and all of our partners and collaborators are counting on that. While the responsibility for choosing the winning team lies with the jury, it is all of us who will carry forward with that the job of integrating that vision with our shared goal of creating a closer-knit community while generating economic opportunities through business growth and tourism. So what comes next? The design competition is the first phase of future parks development along the riverfront. We expect to complete one riverfront project with the winning team within the next 5 years. In order to do so, we'll go through three near future phases of the process. First, we will have an identification of the site and scope of project based on the winning design team's concepts, public input, and park board and partnering institution requirements. Two, we will have budgeting and funding. We will define the budget of that project, public funding resources, and solidification of private sector funding for initial and sustained support. And third will be implementation, design development with active community engagement, followed by construction. And Cecily will talk a little bit about the private sector contribution.
What incredible designs, what incredible amount of work that's gone into these designs. When we embarked on the design competition, the Minneapolis Park and Recreation Board and the Walker and the College of Design and the collaborating organizations, we all knew that we didn't want to have great designs and then, well, wasn't that really entertaining and have them end up in the shelf or in a drawer somewhere. It was really important that we become focused and that we remain focused on true implementation. And so because of that, we have tried throughout this process to engage the community in so many different ways and to engage organizations, individuals, all of you here, and many others in our community. We need you. We saw with our speaker series when we heard about Millennium Park and Highline Park and others that the private sector role was critical. It will be critical here. And tonight we are, the Minneapolis Parks Foundation is beginning to raise money for the Riverfront Project. Something here that you've seen tonight, we want to bring to reality, and hopefully a lot of what you've seen tonight. We want you to be a volunteer. We want you to be a donor. We want you to be an advocate. We want you to be a supporter. At our table out front, we have donor envelopes on our website, mplsparksfoundation.org. You can get more information and donate online. You can get even more information about this competition from the Minneapolis Riverfront Design Competition.com website. There are lots of opportunities for you to decide to sign up, get engaged, and join us on this great journey. David Fisher mentioned several of the collaborating organizations. We welcome many more collaborating organizations. All of the funds that would need to be raised for any of these projects will come from many different sources. The private sector is one of them. There will be many, many opportunities for all of us to brainstorm, and we're expecting and know that these collaborating organizations are going to work very closely with us, as well as with the winning design team, in helping to target these different sources of funding. So if you want to be part of that, we welcome you. Thank you in advance. The journey is going to be fun, and thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you, Cecily. And on behalf of the Minneapolis Park and Recreation Board, we'd like to thank you and your board of directors for their passion and support of Minneapolis Parks. I'd also like to thank the Walker Art Center for hosting this event. There couldn't have been a more appropriate auditorium for the presentation of these inspiring visions and or a more gracious host. Thanks to the students who participated in our youth community engagement curriculum. Their work was very relevant, and we look forward to welcoming them as stewards of our parks and the community in the future. We'd like to again thank the four design teams whose efforts and talents exceeded our admittedly high expectations. If you would please come to the stage as we recognize your team, Ken Smith Workshops. Stosh Landscape Urbanism. TLS KVA. And Turnscape. What is absolutely outstanding to me is that we have four teams who are so committed to the projects that they presented, and we have a community that is so enthralled with what we're going to be doing. Nothing but great things can happen. So thank you again. Just in closing, you can view the team's collective submissions online at MinneapolisRiverfrontDesignCompetition.com. And for all the month of February, these design presentations will be on display here at the Walker Art Center. So you can see the program or our website for details. And of course, thank you to all of you who are here in the cinema this evening and the many more audience members in the Walker's two simulcast rooms and still many, many more viewing via the webcast. It's your passion and commitment that make this community so strong. Thank you very much. If you're like me, this evening has given you a lot to talk about, so let's just do that. Please join us in the Garden Cafe outside the cinema for appetizers and a cash bar until 10 o'clock. And thank you and have a good night.